Selamat pagi Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan sekalian. Shalom, salam sejahtera bagi kita semua. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Om Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya, salam kebajikan. Selamat datang di dalam acara webinar Instructional Librarian, Crucial or Not, pada tanggal 30 April 2021, di mana acara ini merupakan bagian dari rangkaian kegiatan Libanef atau Library Annual Event 2021 yang diselenggarakan oleh Johannes Untorul Library Universitas Pelita Harapan. Kegiatan hari ini akan dibawakan oleh narasumber Ibu Cheryl Taylor, MLS. Perkenalkan, saya Devi Kristiani Zega yang akan memandu acara webinar pada hari ini. Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan sekalian, sebelum acara dimulai, saya akan membacakan rundown acara pada hari ini. Ya. Yang pertama, ada open gate dan absensi. Yang kedua, doa pembuka. Yang ketiga, video sponsor. Keempat, photo sessions dengan narasumber. Kelima, paparan narasumber. Keenam, tanya-jawab. Ketujuh, evaluasi dan video sponsor. Kedelapan, quiz. Dan yang terakhir, ada sertifikat dan penutup. Berikutnya, kami informasikan tata tertib selama acara webinar berlangsung. Yang pertama, gunakan nama asli pada display name. Pastikan sudah terhubung dengan mikrofon dan kamera video. Yang kedua, aktifkan kamera video Anda dan pastikan matikan mikrofon. Yang ketiga, gunakan kolom chat untuk mengajukan pertanyaan dan silakan bicara jika moderator sudah mengizinkan. Yang terakhir, tautan daftar hadir diinformasikan di awal acara. Pastikan nama dan alamat tidak salah saat penulisan di daftar hadir karena akan digunakan dalam pembuatan sertifikat. Selanjutnya, Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan sekalian, kami meminta kesediaannya untuk mengisi absensi di link yang ada di kolom chat, juga bisa di-scan barcode yang ada di layar. Mohon untuk mengisi secara lengkap dan benar karena akan digunakan untuk pembuatan sertifikat. Ya, sekali lagi, mohon untuk mengisi absensi secara lengkap dan benar, karena akan digunakan sekaligus untuk pembuatan sertifikat. Sebelum kita memulai acara, izinkan saya untuk mengawali di dalam doa. Pada kesempatan ini, saya akan memimpin doa di dalam agama Kristen. Bapak, Ibu, serta rekan-rekan boleh mengikuti sesuai agama dan kepercayaan masing-masing. Mari kita berdoa. Tuhan Yesus, terima kasih untuk berkat dan kasih karunia yang tak henti-hentinya Engkau limpahkan kepada kami. Pada hari ini, Tuhan, kami akan mengikuti acara webinar. Biarlah kiranya Engkau yang menjadi pemandu. Biar Engkau yang bukakan hati, telinga, dan pikiran kami, supaya apa yang kami terima tidak menjadi sia-sia, namun menjadi berkat baik bagi kami sendiri, berdampak bagi orang lain, terlebih memuliakan nama-Mu. Untuk itu Bapa, ajar dan bimbing kami, baik narasumber dan seluruh peserta yang hadir pada saat ini. Terima kasih Bapa, kami alaskan doa ini hanya di dalam nama Tuhan Yesus Kristus, Juru Selamat kami yang hidup. Amin. Ya. Terselenggaranya kegiatan pada hari ini tentu tidak lepas dari dukungan banyak pihak. Untuk itu kami ucapkan terima kasih yang sebesar-besarnya, terkhusus kepada para sponsor kami, yang mana acara pada hari ini disponsori oleh Canon, EBSCO, McGraw-Hill, dan Gestor yang telah berpartisipasi untuk membantu kelancaran acara Libanef 2021. Kembali kami sambut, selamat datang Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan yang baru bergabung. Selamat mengikuti acara webinar pada hari ini. Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan sekalian yang baru bergabung, kami juga meminta kesediaannya untuk mengisi absensi di link dan bisa di-scan barcode yang ada di layar. Mohon untuk mengisi secara lengkap dan benar, karena akan digunakan sekaligus untuk pembuatan sertifikat. Sekali lagi, mohon untuk mengisi secara lengkap dan benar, karena akan digunakan sekaligus untuk pembuatan sertifikat. Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan, kami mohon kesediaannya untuk menyaksikan pesan oleh sponsor kami berikut ini, yaitu Canon.
Are you curious? Are you moving? Are you in control? Are you current? Are you out there? Are you built for this? Ready to reimagine photography? The new Canon EOS R full frame mirrorless. It's ready. Are you? Canon, delighting you always. Are you curious? Are you moving? Are you in control? Are you current? Are you out there? Are you built for this? Ready to reimagine photography? The new Canon EOS R full frame mirrorless. It's ready. Are you? Canon, delighting you always. Are you curious? Are you moving? Are you in control? Are you current? Are you out there? Are you built for this? Ready to reimagine photography? The new Canon EOS R full frame mirrorless. It's ready. Are you? Canon, delighting you always.
Baik Bapak Ibu dan rekan-rekan sekalian, kami mohon kesediaan Bapak Ibu dan rekan-rekan untuk membuka kameranya masing-masing, karena saat ini kita akan berfoto bersama. Pada sesi ini kita akan dipandu oleh Pak Bram, silahkan Pak Bram.
Ya, terima kasih MC. Pada hari ini Bapak Ibu, seperti yang sudah diingatkan, kita akan melakukan dokumentasi terlebih dahulu sebelum memulai acaranya. Kami minta Bapak Ibu untuk membuka webcamnya. Ya, terlihat wajah-wajah yang sumringah, yang segar pada pagi hari ini ya, Bapak-Ibu ya. Kita tunggu dulu. Oke, mungkin sudah semua ya. Saya akan hitung 1-3 seperti biasa. Kita tahan di hitungan yang terakhir. 1, 2, 3. Ditahan dulu Bapak Ibu. Yes. Oke, sudah. Terima kasih Bapak Ibu. Waktu dan tempat kami kembalikan kepada MC. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih. Bapak Ibu dan rekan-rekan sekalian, kini tibalah saatnya kita ke acara utama. Mohon diperhatikan dan mematuhi tata tertib yang sudah diumumkan di awal acara demi keberlangsungan dan kelancaran webinar pada hari ini. Kepada moderator, waktu dan tempat kami persilahkan. Terima kasih.
Baik, terima kasih untuk MC. Perkenalkan, saya Yani Karina, moderator hari ini. Saya akan memperkenalkan sedikit tentang topik kita. Ya, topik hari ini adalah Instructional Librarian. Apa itu Instructional Librarian? Jadi di tengah dunia informasi yang banyak, information overload ini, kita membutuhkan keterampilan yang disebut literasi informasi, yaitu keterampilan untuk mengelola informasi dengan benar. Literasi informasi sendiri itu mulai disebutkan pada tahun 74, lalu terus berkembang di semua negara menjadi kebutuhan masyarakat akademis. Saat ini, literasi informasi sudah berkembang menjadi berbagai jenis literasi. Oleh sebab itu, diperlukan peran pustakawan perguruan tinggi untuk memfasilitasi para penggunanya agar dapat memiliki keterampilan literasi informasi ini, yaitu keterampilan untuk mendapatkan, mengelola, menggunakan, dan menyeleksi kebutuhan informasi dengan seksama menggunakan berbagai fasilitas yang disediakan oleh perpustakaannya. Nah, apa ada deskripsi tugas pustakawan yang harus menangani pelatihan ini? Apakah dibutuhkan pustakawan khusus, ataukah bisa dikerjakan, atau harus bisa dikerjakan oleh semua pustakawan? Di Amerika Serikat, sudah dikenal posisi pustakawan perguruan tinggi yang disebut dengan pustakawan instruksional. Tugas pustakawan ini fokus untuk mengembangkan program kelas-kelas literasi informasi. Tidak hanya mampu mengajar, namun juga membuat kurikulum dan modul-modul literasi informasi. Nah, bagaimana pustakawan instruksional untuk memahami kedalaman sebuah subjek keilmuan sehingga bisa membantu pengguna perpustakaan mendapatkan literatur sebagai bidang penelitiannya? Apakah posisi tersebut ada atau tidak? Bagaimana posisi tersebut dilihat di Indonesia dibandingkan dengan Amerika Serikat? Jika ada, apa yang dibutuhkan untuk mengerjakan posisi tersebut? Ya, jadi hari ini kita akan membahas tentang kebutuhan instructional librarian dan perbandingannya dengan praktek yang sudah terjadi di Amerika Serikat. Karena itu kita sudah mengundang narasumber yang sangat kompeten, yaitu Mem. Cheryl Taylor. Ya, beliau lulus dari Master of Library Science dari University of Washington dan sudah aktif menjadi pustakawan sebagai mahasiswa ya, selagi mengerjakan kuliahnya di sebagai graduate student di University of Washington. Kemudian menjadi pustakawan interlibrary loan dan college librarian di Dort College Library, yang kemudian beliau naik menjadi Director of Library Services dari Holtz Library di Dordt College masih. Ya, dari tahun 97 ya, sudah lama sekali, pengalamannya sudah banyak, sampai 2015 ketika beliau pindah ke Indonesia. Di Indonesia, dari tahun 2015 sampai sekarang, beliau bekerja sebagai Library Coordinator for Pelita Harapan Foundation, Yayasan Pelita Harapan. Ya. Beliau sudah banyak melakukan presentasi di berbagai acara dan semiloka kepustakawanan. Dia juga memiliki banyak pengalaman ketika menjabat menjadi Director of Library Services di institusi akademik dan berpartisipasi di konsul-konsul perpustakaan perguruan tinggi dan pustakawan asosiasi pustakawan profesional di Amerika Serikat sampai tahun 2015 ketika beliau pindah ke Indonesia. Ya, kita sudah tahu ya, jadi ya topik dan kompetensi dari speaker kita hari ini, pembicara kita hari ini, ya, pembicara kita akan berbicara dalam bahasa Inggris. Ya, kami persilahkan, Ma'am Cheryl, you can start to your presentation now.
Just one second.
Yeah, okay.
I'm having some difficulty. Yanni, are you only seeing the one portion of the screen or the whole screen?
Yeah, we can see your presentation.
Just your part of the screen, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, great. All right. Well, I am delighted to be able to speak with you today. I think I understood Yanni's introduction to me, although it was in Bahasa, and my Bahasa is not very good, but I think I know what she said. And I hope that it was highlighted that the focus today will be on instructional librarians in higher education and university settings. As she said already, I'm the library coordinator for the Yayasan, and I work also with school libraries. And so the Sekolah Dian Harapan Schools and the Sekolah Pelita Harapan Schools. And I know some of the people that I work with there said they were gonna watch my presentation, and I told them they really don't want to or shouldn't, because it's gonna focus on universities. And I already saw that one of them is online in this session. And so I already warned them, but it's okay if they want to listen. But what I am going to focus on today is the importance of instruction librarians, because it's related to the importance of instructions in university libraries. So the topics that I'm covering today, or the outline of my presentation, you can see it on the screen. I want to focus on the importance of informational literacy programs, or information instruction programs, and then the concepts and duties of an instructional librarian, to let you know what that is, what an instructional librarian is and what they do, what skills you need to be, need to have to be an instructional librarian, the position or role of an instructional librarian in a university library setting, and then what is typically taught by an instructional librarian in a university. So that's kind of the outline of what we're gonna cover in the next 40 minutes, and then we'll have time for question and answers. All right, so let's start with this. There's a famous quote that says, "Knowledge is power." I'm sure you have all heard of that quote. universities depend on knowledge. That's how they transmit their mission. That is why students pay hundreds and thousands of rupiah to attend universities, because students want knowledge. But knowledge is not possible without access to information. And fortunately for us, academic libraries are all about information. So I love this quote that says, "Library instruction programs can provide a mechanism for that transmission of knowledge. Library instruction programs foster information searching skills and understanding of information organization." So in order for an academic library to fully support the educational mission of their university, of which they're a part, and again, if the university didn't exist, the academic library would not exist. So the academic library must support the educational mission of the institution. It is necessary for librarians to tailor not just their collections, but also their instructional methods to the furtherance of the curriculum and the institution as a whole. In other words, all university libraries should have education or educating as part of their mission statement. And if you are at a university library, you might want to review what your mission statement is. Here's the mission statement for us here at UPEHA's library. And you'll see that in it, to support the learning and research activities of the university by providing quality services, providing access to information resources in all formats, and educating users to use information resources and technology. Education should be part of every academic library's mission statement. If it's not, you will want to revise your mission statement. Because if it's not part of your mission statement, it means you're not connecting your mission as the academic library to the mission of your institution. And the mission of your institution is education. So I hope that starts to let you see the importance of information literacy or instruction programs within an academic library. And so most of what I'm going to speak about today is from my experience of 25 plus years as an academic librarian in America. And I'll just start by saying that every academic library in America has an instruction program. It's basically not optional. It is mandatory. It's part of the accrediting standards. And I reference their ACRL, that stands for the Association of College and Research Libraries. It's the largest body of academic, university, and college libraries in America. It's part of the American Library Association. And every academic and library in America is part of it. And the standard says that there is an educational role of academic libraries. It's to partner in the educational mission of the institution to develop and support information literate learners who can discover, access, and use information effectively for their academic success, research, and most importantly, lifelong learners. We want the students that come through our universities not only to succeed in their university studies, but we want them to succeed in life. We want them to become lifelong learners. So that's the situation in America. In Indonesia, Pak Dama, who's our manager here at UPEHA, he says that information literacy programs exist, and some are quite advanced, like I believe ours here at UPEHA is, but he estimates that 60% of academic libraries around Indonesia are still confused about what information literacy is and who is actually in charge of providing it. So that means that there's a lot of work to do in Indonesia to bring Indonesian university libraries up to Western standards. So to have an information instruction program, you need to have instructional librarians. And so that's really the focus of this talk today. So I've been asked to describe the concept and duties of an instructional librarian. So an instructional librarian, quite simply, is any librarian with instruction or teaching responsibilities. And again, the Association of College and Research Libraries defines it as any activity in the classroom or other instructional environments, which could mean in the library, or including online, as we've all learned due to COVID, where the librarian interacts directly with the learners. So the librarian employs best practices of teaching in library for integrating information literacy into higher education. And again, my slides will be available later, so you can go back and read some of this slower or even translate it into Bahasa if that's easier for you. All librarians in America have some training in instructional methods. It's basically part of any MLS program, Master in Library Science program, which in America is an S2 level program. It's a component even in all of the basic required core courses that you need to take, including courses on things like reference. In a reference course, you would learn about instructional methods. A librarian in America can also specialize just in instructional librarianship. And this isn't new in America. The instructional services librarian position first began to appear in university libraries in the United States in the 1970s already, around the time that computers started to become used more and libraries became a little more difficult for the average user to navigate on their own. And today, an instructional librarian is a mainstay in every academic library. I did a search yesterday of Indeed.com, which is a website for jobs in America. And right now there are 893 job openings for instructional librarian positions. So that's a lot of positions. Now, what does an instructional librarian do? What's their duties? Their primary duty is to teach either individuals or groups in the campus community. So that might be doing an instruction session for students. It might be doing a one-on-one session with a lecturer. It might be going to a faculty departmental meeting and doing instruction for the group of lecturers that are at that meeting. It can be online, it can be in person, but the primary focus is on teaching. And then you can see the list of other duties there. Instructional design is becoming a bigger part of the instructional program as more and more stuff is available online. It also involves marketing instructional activities around the campus community, doing assessment of the instruction program, see what's working well and what needs improving. Integrating instructional technology into other learning activities. And that can even mean partnering with the edutech department on your campus, making sure that instructional stuff is embedded inside your institution's course management system and other things. I won't read the entire list. Now, an instructional librarian can simply be a standalone position that a person's main and only task is instructional librarian. That's very common in America. But it can also be combined with other jobs. So my first job, actually my second job out of my S2 program, was I was basically a reference and instructional librarian. So that's very common to combine it with something else depending on the size of the institution. In a major university, you would have multiple instructional librarians. In a very small university with maybe only 1,000 or 2,000 students, you would maybe just have a person whose duties are reference and instruction. So it depends on the size of the institution. But a major university in America is going to have a team of up to a dozen instructional librarians. So here's just an example. When I looked on the job website yesterday, Western Kentucky University has an opening right now for an online learning and information literacy librarian. And you can see what kinds of duties they have. They have to plan, design, deliver, and assess online learning materials. They have to teach users how to use information. Here's another one. They can have different names. And so I've been calling it instructional librarian. It can also be called teaching librarian. You can see here the top one from New York University. They're calling it critical pedagogy librarian. The next one from Rutgers University is that combined one that's very common in America, reference and instruction librarian, where a librarian does reference work one-on-one, helping people with finding research and resources, but it's also the same person that's in charge of teaching instructional sessions. University of Nevada, Las Vegas, they are calling theirs a teaching and learning librarian. Now, the position can also be combined with a subject specialization. So it's very typical in major universities in America that the university is so large and there's so many different faculty that librarians are assigned specifically to a faculty. So here's an example from Auburn University where they're looking for a chemistry librarian. And often this position requires that the person has, in addition to an S2 in librarianship, they also have an S2 degree in chemistry. So they're an expert in chemistry and an expert in librarianship. So this person would be a chemistry expert librarian. And the main tasks of this position is to do information literacy for the chemistry, engineering, S1 and S2 students. So it can get very specific in a major university. Now, what skills are needed by an instructional librarian? Really, the focus of the skills for an instructional librarian should really be on pedagogical processes and abilities. And again, I won't read all of these. You can go back to them later. But it really needs to take on the skills of someone that can use diverse approaches to teaching and learning to improve student engagement. You want someone that can teach, but make it really exciting, that really grabs students' attention and gets them excited about what they're learning. But it also really needs to focus on the learner and what they're learning. It needs to be inclusive, it needs to be relevant. The next point there, it needs to promote critical thinking. You actually have to get students to think about how to use information, not just tell them do A, do B, do C. That's not critical thinking. Higher education institutions in America are not about memorization and rote recall. They are about critical thinking. And information instruction needs to be focused on critical thinking as well. That's the only way they're going to become lifelong learners, is if they actually learn to think on their own. All right, so how do you get those skills? Well, in America, you get it when you enter an S2 program to become a librarian. And as I said before, it's completely embedded in the program. Everybody learns instructional methods in an S2 program in America, no matter what type of librarian you want to become. So here's an example from my own experience. Yanni already mentioned I got my S2 from the University of Washington, which is located in Seattle, Washington. And in my program, these were two of the required classes. One was instructional and training strategies for information professionals. So we were taught to what we were taught the knowledge and skills in applying theories of information literacy, teaching and learning instruction, how to design and develop instructional programs for different user groups. So if somebody eventually became a children's librarian, they would then have those skills to apply to their user group. If someone became a school librarian, they could then apply those to working in a K-12 situation. If someone became a university librarian, they could apply it there. And then down at the bottom, you could see there were also optional courses you can take at the University of Washington that focus more specifically. But it was part of the S2 program. Now, I don't know what programs here in Indonesia look like, if it's even part of the training program for librarians. If it's not, that's a chance for you as a librarian to advocate and try to push for organizations in Indonesia to consider that that needs to be part of training of librarians. You can see the second example here, the skills approach to information, communication, and technology is introducing library school students to the Big Six. And we'll talk about that a little bit later because that's actually used here at UPEHA. That's the instructional informational literacy program they have. So at least at University of Washington, you learn that program while you are still in your S2 program. Okay, so if it's not part of your degree program, whether S1 or S2, then those skills need to be developed other ways. It's very common, if you've not learned it through a program, that you have to learn it on the job. Once you're hired, you get hired at UPEHA, and then Pak Dama says, okay, you're going to be an instructional librarian. Well, then he's going to make sure you get the training on the job of what that means. Someone can get it through additional education. In America, at least, workshops and conferences offer continuing education opportunities, or you could go to a workshop to learn more about being an instructional librarian. The Association of College and Research Organization has a national conference every other year, and there's a whole entire track of that focused just to workshops in information literacy and instructional librarian. So again, I don't know if that's something here in Indonesia, but it's certainly something that can be worked towards. I know Pak Dama, whenever possible, tries to provide workshops in different conferences and events focusing on information literacy. Professional reading. There's so much out there, especially on the internet now, about instructional librarianship. At the end of my presentation, I'll have links to some of the websites that provide information. But there's even free webcasts available online. Here's one I found from the ACRL organization, Information Literacy Instruction at a Social Distance, Strategies for Moving Online. So now that we're dealing with COVID, how do you move instruction online? It's a free webcast that you could go and watch. Okay, so how does an instructional librarian position fit within a university library? Already in the early 1980s in America, the literature was talking about that the instructional department, the instructional librarians needed to be considered at equal level to that of reference, circulation, cataloging, and acquisitions. So that was how many years ago? 40 years ago already in America. No, not quite that many. They were already saying instructional librarian, a position that had started to become popular in the early 1970s. So within 10 years, they recognized the importance of this new position and said, this is as important as a cataloging librarian. This is as important as an acquisitions librarian. When I looked on Indeed.com to look up how many cataloging position openings there are in America right now, you can see that there's only 400 cataloging positions, and yet there's over 800 instruction positions. That alone shows the importance of the position in university libraries in America. So my experience in my years working professionally in America is that reference and instruction librarians are basically on equal par as each other. And as I told you already, oftentimes they can be combined into a single position in a smaller university. And they are nowadays in America considered to be more important than cataloging, acquisitions, and circulation. So in the 1980s, they were saying, this is new, but it's at least equal. Now in America, it is far more important than the positions of cataloging, acquisitions, and circulation. Mostly because those positions, cataloging, acquisitions, and circulation, are often now filled in American universities by people that don't have a library degree. Whether it's in America, you can only get an S2 degree. You can't get an S1 degree in librarianship. As things like copy cataloging have become more popular, as people use different integrated library systems, things like cataloging and circulation are no longer in America filled by people with an S2 degree. But reference and instruction librarians are very much popular positions, and the positions that a university will for sure hire an S2 librarian for before they'll fill other positions. So I hope you understand from what's going on in America that an instructional librarian is a very crucial and valid position. So what is actually taught by an instructional librarian? I referenced earlier Big Six being an information literacy program or process. It's the one that's used here at UPEHA. But again, since I am not actually teaching as an instructional librarian right now in my current position, I'm actually gonna let Yanni speak about that and what topics are typically taught by an instructional librarian here in Indonesia, as typical to her position as an instructional librarian. There's a link there to the Big Six's website. You can go there and get all the information you want about their program. So in conclusion, is it crucial or not? And my answer is yes. And in fact, in America, it's already been determined in the course of the last 30 years that it's a crucial position. And as I said before, every academic library in America has an instructional librarian, if not a team of them, to carry out the mission of the library, which should be directly connected to the mission of the university, which is education based on knowledge. Because as I started my talk today, knowledge is power, and that's what people want. So here at the end is a list of links to guidelines for instruction programs at academic libraries, information literacy framework from the ACRL, objectives for instructional standards, more about the roles and the strengths of teaching librarians, and the actual standards used in America for libraries. So I actually took less time than was allotted to me, but I think that's okay. And so Yanni, I think, was going to add some more about what topics instructional librarians typically teach. So Yanni, I don't know if you want to do that first or field questions, and then you can talk about that. I will let you decide that.
Okay, yeah, I will share a little bit about the information literacy course first. So I will speak about it in Bahasa, in Indonesian. Yeah. Jadi seperti yang diminta oleh Mem Cheryl ya, kalau misalkan kita di Indonesia ini, kita di UPH terutama ya, instructional librarian itu banyak mengambil kelas dari didasarkan dari the big six ya. Itu mulai dari mencari informasi seperti online research, di mana kita bisa mencari informasi, bagaimana tips dan trik untuk mencari informasi yang lebih tepat dan akurat. Lalu tentang plagiarisme, penggunaan informasi, bagaimana cara menggunakan informasi dengan benar dan proper, bagaimana memberikan kredit, bagaimana memberikan daftar pustaka dan citasi agar dapat memanfaatkan informasi dengan baik. Lalu juga ada sintesis, bagaimana mengambil informasi-informasi dari yang inti dari suatu sumber yang lain, lalu kemudian dituangkan ke dalam penulisan. Bagaimana menulis yang baik, yang tidak terlalu mirip dengan sumber aslinya, dan bagaimana membuat semuanya itu menjadi suatu tulisan yang komprehensif, yang baik, yang terstruktur, gitu. Ya, itu yang bisa saya bagikan tentang kelas-kelas literasi informasi yang di UPH terutama. Ya, juga tadi kita sudah mendengar tentang materi Mem Cheryl yang lain ya. Jadi kenapa kami mengajarkan semuanya itu literasi di program literasi informasi? Karena tadi seperti yang dilihat, yang sudah dibicarakan oleh Mem Cheryl, informasi itu sangat penting. Knowledge is power, dan karena itu literasi informasi sangat penting. Literasi informasi itu sejalan dengan tujuan perpustakaan untuk menjadikan para penggunanya lifelong learner, ya, pembelajar seumur hidup. Karena ini penting adanya instructional librarian itu atau teaching librarian yang tugasnya adalah untuk mengajar, membuat kurikulum sesuai kebutuhan, dan mempromosikan kelas tersebut agar banyak yang mengambil dan memiliki keterampilan-keterampilan untuk menjadi pembelajar seumur hidup. Ya. Untuk itu diperlukan keterampilan-keterampilan pedagogi, ya, pengajaran. Dan tadi kita sudah melihat juga bagaimana dan di mana mendapatkannya. Kalau misalkan di Amerika, itu sudah menjadi course wajib, suatu kelas wajib di master graduate, ya, pasca sarjana, ya, karena di Amerika itu kita bisa mendapatkan gelar sebagai pustakawan, ya, library science itu di graduate ya, S2 master. Kemudian juga bisa on the job training, kita juga bisa mendapatkan berbagai, tadi sudah diberikan webcast ya, sumber-sumber yang bisa kita lihat untuk mengasah keterampilan. Kemudian juga ini kalau misalkan perpustakaannya kecil, itu biasanya memang digabung dengan berbagai posisi lain, ya biasa disebut, biasa yang paling biasa digabung dengan reference librarian. Bisa juga diminta untuk menjadi subject specialist dan mengajar khusus di suatu jurusan tertentu. Nah, sekarang posisi ini dianggap lebih penting daripada pustakawan-pustakawan, posisi pustakawan lain di Amerika ya. Awalnya ini dianggap sebagai posisi yang baru dan sejajar, namun sekarang bisa dilihat dari banyaknya pencari pekerjaan antara cataloging librarian dan instructional librarian, lebih banyak yang mencari instructional librarian. Dan kalau misalkan ada yang hire, mencari, itu kemungkinan besar posisi yang di hire pertama kali adalah instructional librarian. Baru nanti akan di-fill, diisi posisi-posisi yang lain. Karena posisi yang lain sekarang bisa digantikan dengan orang-orang dari jurusan lain, selain library science, selain ilmu perpustakaan, gitu ya. Jadi kita bisa lihat di sini sebagai sepenting apa instructional librarian, terutama di Amerika. Ya, kita lihat di Indonesia juga sudah mulai naik kayak literasi informasi dan kebutuhan-kebutuhan terhadap pustakawan instructional yang biasa digabung. Mungkin di Indonesia lebih banyak pustakawan referensi yang merekap bergabung job desk-nya dengan pustakawan instruksional. Juga ada teacher librarian yang biasanya bekerja di sekolah, ya tadi lebih ke arah universitas, tapi kalau misalkan di sekolah biasa disebut sebagai teacher librarian. Gitu ya. Kita buka sesi pertanyaan. Tadi sudah ada pertanyaan. Kalau misalkan ada yang ingin bertanya, bisa menggunakan bahasa Indonesia. Nanti akan kita bantu ke bahasa Inggris. Ya, tapi Mem Cheryl akan jawab dalam bahasa Inggris. Ya. So, we have our first question for Mem Cheryl. So this is from Hendrikus Franz Josef from Dinas Perpustakaan dan Arsip Daerah, Archive and Library. Yeah, the question is, the first one, what kind of training or workshop for American librarian? I assume this is for instructional library. Ian. And the second one is, what about librarian position in USA? Are they government official like in Indonesia, or maybe only private institution librarian? And then the last one is, instructional librarian, is it similar or the same with special librarian? For Mem Cheryl, you can answer.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so first of all, what kind of training or workshops are available for instructional librarians? In America, professional development is a very popular or common thing. So when you get hired at a university as a librarian, whether it's instruction or reference and instruction, you are usually given a budget to attend conferences and workshops. And they're very common. And so, as you know, America's quite large. And so oftentimes your university will be in a state, like maybe it's in California. the state of California, the library organizations in the state of California, and again, they would have different ones. They would have ones for public libraries. So they would have a California Public Library Association, a California University Library Association. They are going to have annual conferences, multiple day conferences that are going to cover things like reference, instructional training, collection development. There's going to be vendors there selling books from their university press. And that's where librarians go to get additional training once they already have their S2. And again, each librarian is usually given a budget. And so they are able to go to a 2 or 3 day conference or training session within their state to get this additional professional development. So that's a very, very common practice in America. And then, as I mentioned before, the Association of College and Research Libraries has a major national-wide conference every other year. That's usually a 4-day event. And at that conference, there are specific tracks for different types of librarianship. So you can spend 3 days going to presentations or workshops just on instructional librarianship, and or you could go to a track just on library administration or just on reference. And so that's, again, where most librarians get their professional development training, and it's very common that happens. Now, library positions in USA are rarely government officials. That's very uncommon. So a university can either be a publicly owned university, like University of California in Los Angeles, UCLA. That's a public university. It's owned by the state of California, but the people that work at it are not government officials. They're employees of the state of California, but that's very different than government officials here. And so, in fact, in America, I mean, I know thousands of librarians, but I don't know any librarian in America that's a government official. It's very, very unusual. The only ones that are government official is each state. So I lived for many years in Iowa. The state of Iowa had a state library. The people that worked at that state library were government officials for the state of Iowa. And then, of course, the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C. I'm sure you've heard of that. That is really the only governmental library in America. So the people that work at the Library of Congress would be government employees. The other structure for universities in America is private universities. So Harvard University is a private university. It's not owned or operated by the state of Massachusetts. It's owned by itself. It's a private institution. Yale is a private university. And then anybody that works at a private university like Harvard, Yale, Rutgers, they, of course, are not government officials. They are employees of that institution. So government officers or government officials be in library positions in America is very uncommon. So instructional librarian, is it similar or the same with a special librarian? In America, what is typically considered a special librarian would be your typical librarian jobs are you work in a public library, which is also not a very big thing here in Indonesia. But in America, every single city in town in America has a public library. People go into children librarianship. People go into school librarianship or university librarianship. Those are the four big ones. And then the other branch is what in America is called special librarianship. That tends to be if you work for a law firm, or you work for a corporation, like maybe you're the librarian and you work for Microsoft or some other major company. So special librarian in America usually means you work for a legal firm or a corporation. And so instructional librarian is within the realm of the university librarian grouping of librarians. Instructional librarian is one of those. A reference librarian, the director or manager of the library, the instructional librarian. Again, large universities might have a separate instructional designer librarian. They might have a special collections librarian, archives and special collections. But instructional librarian is within that realm of only academic librarians, which again depends if you're at a private university or a public university.
Okay, thank you for material for your answer. Sudah terjawab pertanyaannya, Pak? Ya, baik. Jadi ya tadi ya sudah dijawab kalau misalkan training atau workshop di Amerika itu sangat biasa sampai ada 3 hari konferensi dan untuk meningkatkan professional development. Dan kalau misalkan posisi pustakawan itu sangat jarang yang PNS ya. Jadi walaupun mereka kerjanya di perpustakaan publik, yang tadi menurut Mem Cheryl jarang ada di Indonesia ya. Saya pernah memperlihatkan public library in Indonesia to Mem Cheryl, and she said that it's no library because it's so small. Yeah, so in their eyes, yeah, in USA, the city, our city library is not adequate to be called library. Ya. Lalu tadi jadi ya special librarian itu sama mungkin di Amerika sama di Indonesia, yang disebut dengan special librarian itu lebih ke pustakawan yang mempunyai spesialisasinya sendiri, seperti pustakawan hukum, pustakawan anak-anak, lalu tadi pustakawan mungkin untuk Microsoft ya, jadi IT dan segala macamnya gitu. Dari pertanyaan ini saya mau elaborasi pertanyaan. So from these questions, I have additional questions from you for you. So so maybe because instructional librarian is not common in Indonesia, so they mistake it with special librarian. But did special library also have their own instructional librarian, or is it only in the higher education library?
It's typically only in higher education. Usually a special librarian, like if you were hired to be the corporate librarian for a company like Microsoft, or even not such a big company, you would typically kind of do a wide variety of tasks, which would include more, you would help the people that work at that company find the information they need, or maybe they're looking for proof of a patent or things like that. But you would also work on, you know, helping them figure out how to search databases to find the information themselves the next time. But it's a very different clientele in a special library, whereas the instructional librarian position is pretty much usually only focused in the field of education where you're trying to educate people. In a special library, like a corporate library, the role of the librarian is quite different because what you're trying to accomplish is different. You're trying to help the other employees of the company get the data they need to carry out their job duties. Whereas instructional librarian is focused more on the learning process, which again fits within an academic institution, a university.
Okay, I see. So it's they might need similar skills. Okay, I'm sorry for the technical error. Yeah. So for special librarian, they also teach some skills to their clientele, but it's different. The purpose is different. Ya, jadi kalau misalkan di perguruan tinggi, ya jadi tadi ya kemampuannya itu tetap harus dimiliki, tapi ada perbedaan tujuan dan klien, ya pengguna dari perpustakaan itu sendiri apa yang diinginkannya. Kalau misalkan di instructional librarian itu memang tujuannya untuk mengedukasi dan bagaimana agar kita bisa jadi mendidik student, siswa, mahasiswa untuk menjadi pembelajar seumur hidup. Sementara kalau misalkan di special library, mereka mengajar, tapi tujuannya untuk mempermudah proses pengambilan data dan informasi dari universitas, untuk memperlancar institusinya ya. Jadi kalau misalkan di perusahaan untuk bisa lebih mudah mendapatkan informasi untuk menjalankan pekerjaan dan seterusnya. Saya akan bertanya satu lagi untuk yang what kind of training. Yeah. So I have another question about the training for American librarian. So you said that there is conference in America. So the focus of instructional librarian is to teach. If they can develop their own curriculum, is there any sharing platform, maybe in the conference, to share the curriculum that they have in their own institution?
Yes, there is a lot of sharing. American librarians love to share with each other. So if someone comes up with a great idea, they love to go to a conference and then be a speaker and share their idea with others so that others can freely use that same stuff. So that's very common, sharing between librarians, and especially if you've developed a great curriculum. In America, it's also very common. There have been a number of free open source information literacy software programs that librarians have developed, and they make it open source that any other librarian can take it and adapt it for their own university and use that online free instructional. We did that at my university. There was a program out of Texas called TILT, Texas Information Literacy Tutorial. And they would allow you to take that and adapt it for your own university so that we at our university didn't have to create our own online software program. There's even great, when I do a little bit of instruction here with our International Teachers College, teaching them about plagiarism. And we actually use an online drag and drop tutorial about learning about how to formulate citations correctly. And that was created by Cornell University. But we can use that program for free because another library said, oh, one of the things we need to teach is don't plagiarize. And that means that students need to learn how to understand the anatomy of a citation so they can cite things properly. And so Cornell made this great little software program. It's a web-based software program where it says, it gives you an example, and then you have to drag and drop the citation parts into order, and then you can click and see if it's correct, and it'll say yes or no. But other librarians, instructional librarians, created that, and they freely share it with any other librarians in the world to use. Now, that program's in English, which is why I used it, because I was working with students that were learning in English. But anything like that, open educational resources, can be used by anybody else freely. So librarians in America have a great ethos of sharing what they've learned and discovered with others so that others don't have to also recreate things from scratch.
Okay, that's neat. Yeah, maybe I just haven't discovered the server Indonesian librarian, but I think there is, yeah, because I know that there is a forum for sharing in Indonesia for librarians also. Okay, so we have another question from another participant. Kita ke pertanyaan kedua. Oke, sebentar ya. Jadi kalau pertanyaan yang kedua itu dari Zahra dari Universitas Trisakti. Yeah. So the question is, so if you want to become a special librarian, for example, law librarian, we don't have a degree in law, can we become a special librarian by joining trainings?
Usually in America, to become, it depends where you want to become a special librarian. If you want to become a librarian for a law firm, you actually have to also have a law degree. If you want to be a librarian for a corporation, like Google or Microsoft, no, then you just need your regular S2 degree.
Ya, jadi tadi ya, jadi kalau misalkan di Amerika memang dia beda sistem sama kita, jadi kalau misalkan mereka jadi law librarian, itu biasanya mereka S1-nya sudah ambil jurusan hukum. Baru S2-nya mereka ambil librarianship dan akhirnya bisa jadi pustakawan hukum. Ya, jadi di sini biasanya seperti itu. Ya, di sini juga bisa seperti itu, tapi kalau misalkan dibalik S1 ya di S2 hukum ya itu biasanya juga ada sekarang di penjurusannya untuk mengambil untuk jadi pustakawan hukum gitu. Oke, ya sudah terjawab ya pertanyaannya Zahra. Oke, ya kita ada satu pertanyaan lagi, mungkin panitia sudah bisa menampilkan pertanyaan. Ya. Jadi ya tadi untuk training, jadi tidak bisa dengan hanya pelatihan ya. Jadi biasanya akan diambil perlu degree juga kalau misalkan mau seperti itu. Oke, kita tunggu sebentar. Kita sudah mendapatkan pertanyaan tadi dari ya yang di chat ya ada ya. Kita jawab dulu dari Har Krisyati Kamil. Pertanyaannya adalah, how is the relationship between instructional librarian and faculty member?
Yes, that's a great question. It should be a very close and collaborative relationship. Instructional librarians at universities in America are expected to work very closely with faculty members and lecturers. And I showed you the one example, the chemistry librarian opening at Auburn University. That librarian actually becomes a member of that faculty. But the relationship needs to be very close. The instructional librarian has to create a strong partnership, a collaboration with the people in the different faculty, because it's through them that they know what students are learning about, what kinds of assignments they have, what they need to do. And let me just add some extra information. Instructional and information literacy at universities in America is sometimes a multi-tier approach. So in America, at many universities, students are required to take core classes. You're required to take, you know, a class, a history class. You're required to take a psychology class. You're required to take a science class. You're required to take a variety of classes. So there's this list of core requirements that you must take. Then you go into your specialization. If you want to become a business, you want to major in business, then you would begin taking, after you've had these basic classes, kind of in all the different areas of knowledge, then you begin to take business classes. And then by your last year of university, your fourth year, then you're taking the advanced business classes. So oftentimes instruction will kind of match up with those tiers. When students start university, they get a basic introduction to information in general, because they're taking a lot of different classes, but they're still going to have to do assignments in those classes, write papers in those classes, give speeches. So they kind of have to know how to search for information in general and within some of these disciplines. But because they're not going to major in those disciplines, they don't need to like go real deep into learning about information in that discipline. Then when they enter into their program, their selected program, like let's say I'm going to become a psychology, I want to study psychology. Well, when I was taking my introduction language and grammar class, English and grammar, and my intro math class and my intro history class, I didn't need to know about the psych info database. But now that I'm entering a discipline, I need to learn what the psych info database is, how to search it, what's the common terminology in the field of psychology, how do you cite things in psychology? Well, in psychology, you use APA format. But if I had chosen to be a history major, they would have had me using Chicago manual style. So then in my psychology introductory courses, I need to have information literacy that's focused at psychology. And then when I get to the end of my time and I have to write my scripty, then I really need to learn stuff. I need to learn how to do a literature review. I need to learn, you know, maybe the general psych info database isn't specific enough. Maybe I need to search a database that looks more very in-depth into diagnostic mental illnesses. And so oftentimes in America, it's a tiered approach even for information literacy, depending on what level you're studying, you're gonna need to learn different levels of information. So the instructional librarian needs to work very closely with the faculty member to know what's being taught at those different levels, especially within the selected program of study. So it's a very close working relationship and collaboration.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Jadi sudah terjawab ya, kalau misalkan antara pustakawan instructional dan dosen ataupun member pengajar yang lain, anggota pengajar yang lain, itu harus dekat hubungannya, karena memang harus mengerti sekali tentang kebutuhan informasi apa yang dibutuhkan oleh mahasiswa. terjawab ya Pak atau ya kita ke pertanyaan selanjutnya. Ya, jadi tadi sudah ada di chat dari Purwani Istiana dari UGM. The question is there a certain level of education to become an instructional librarian, especially with for collaboration with lecturers? Yeah. So this is a follow-up question from the last question.
Not in general. You would to become an instructional librarian and partner and collaborate with faculty at most universities. It's just the regular S2 degree. Now I see somebody mentioning in that question something about SPSS. That's what I was talking about, like with psychology, the tiered level. When you're just taking your intro core classes, you don't need to know about SPSS if you're going to be a psychology major. But once you go into the field of psychology, you would get general introduction into using SPSS. But when you're ready to do your scripty, then you really need to know how to use SPSS. So that's what I was talking about, the tiered or the scaffolding approach to giving students the information they need at the level they need it. But again, the partnership with the lecturers, the faculty members, and the instructional librarian is very much seen in America as a partnership. Because the lecturers, the ultimate goal, right, is the success of the students, that they graduate out of the program. And so the faculty member and the librarian see themselves as a partnering in ensuring student success. Of course, the faculty member is going to want to make sure that the student knows, a psychology major, how to use SPSS. So they're going to partner with the librarian and say, this is, I think, the best place to begin to teach them about SPSS and the Psych Info database. So it's a very close partnership. But a special degree is not needed to be a general information literacy or instructional librarian in the general university setting.
Okay, yeah, so we have answered that. So this one about SPSS. Wait a minute, sorry for my double. Yeah, for the SPSS, the question is, how is a librarian are asked to give a class, information literacy class, about a thesis writing guide and SPSS for statistics? Do we have to know about all that, or can we ask for IT librarian to teach about that? Because previously are said that IT librarian can be said to be a special librarian.
Okay, yeah, so if that's the structure here, the point is everybody possible should partner together to make something happen. So maybe in a case where if IT already is very, they know how to use SPSS, but the instructional librarian is not familiar with that, then yes, the instructional librarian would want to work with IT and with the lecturer to figure out who's going to be the best person to do it. So oftentimes it's looking broader at what's the instructional program. Well, we know for psychology majors, they need to learn about Psych Info database and searching. Well, the instructional librarian can say, oh, well, yes, I can cover that. But they also need to learn SPSS before they can work on their scripty. And then maybe the instructional librarian will say, I don't have training in that. Whereas a different instructional librarian might say, well, I do. Then it's a matter of, well, who can help us? Okay, well, if it's IT, let's bring them into the program and cover that. So the idea is partnering together as employees of the institution to get the job done and figuring out who can help get the job done.
Okay, thank you. So yeah, the one asking is Raden Ola Triana from Universitas Bayangkara Jakarta. Ya, tadi saya mau panduan menulis skripsi dengan pustakawan IT, apakah saya salah mengerti kalau pustakawan IT maksudnya information technology? Karena information technology dan panduan menulis skripsi mungkin juga masih belum ini ya, mungkin ada penjelasan tambahan. Ya, kalau tidak ada, tadi seperti yang sudah dijelaskan oleh Mem Syaril, bahwa dicari orang yang paling cocok untuk memberikan informasi yang dibutuhkan oleh mahasiswa, instruksi yang dibutuhkan oleh mahasiswa. Apabila pustakawan IT ternyata memang menguasai panduan menulis skripsi dan SPSS untuk statistika, maka ya walaupun dia special librarian, pustakawan spesial, dia bisa mengajar jadi instructional librarian juga di topik tersebut. Ya. Selanjutnya, we have another question from Uli Pitaloka from Loi Ajaran Family Library. The question is, how do you cope with students' different levels of reading skills so that the objectives in literacy information literacy can be successfully achieved?
Yeah, that's a great question. Students come into university with different skill levels. And so, and some students in information literacy session, and maybe Yanni can also address this, some students come in and are quite advanced. They've used academic libraries for whatever reason. They have high reading skill levels. They don't need as much instruction, whereas other students are really struggling, and so the class can be very mismatched. So it's just a matter of sometimes it's helpful to do, if possible, if you know that there's great variance in the skill level of students, it might be possible to break them into two different groups, a beginner group and an advanced group. And that can maybe be done by, you know, just figuring that out in advance, or maybe a pretest can be used, you know, give them 5 questions about different things related to what you're going to cover in the session. And if they don't already know the answers to all of them, they're in the beginner group. If someone knows maybe 2 of the answers, but not the other 3, maybe they're in an intermediate group. And so you might have to teach differently to different groups of students. Yanni, maybe you can address that, because I know you do sessions with the teachers' college students, and they probably are at very different levels sometimes of their skills. And so how do you deal with the fact that you have different levels in the same class? Do you divide them up or try to gauge their ability levels ahead of time?
Okay, so I will answer in Bahasa. Jadi kalau misalkan di Indonesia yang diajarkan literasi informasi itu menurut saya masih sangat basic sekali ya. Jadi kalau misalkan diminta kelas literasi informasi itu biasanya juga mulai dari yang sangat basic. Tuh, tadi seperti yang sudah dijelaskan oleh Mem Syaril, kami punya mahasiswa-mahasiswa dari luar daerah yang bahkan kadang-kadang dulu sekarang sudah lebih baik. Dulu itu ada mahasiswa yang baru datang dan jarang sekali memegang komputer. Jadi bagaimana cara mengajarkan mereka untuk mendapatkan skill internet ketika mereka sendiri jarang sekali untuk memegang komputer gitu ya. Jadi untuk kelas-kelas tersebut, jadi kami tidak membagi, karena biasanya itu pembagian kelas itu tidak bergantung pada pustakawan di sini, praktiknya di sini. Ya, kita juga tidak ada pretest untuk mengetahui kemampuan mahasiswa bagaimana kemampuan literasi informasinya. Tapi kita sudah punya, ya kalau misalkan sudah sering memberikan kelas, itu kita juga sudah punya gambaran tentang profil mahasiswanya. Kalau misalkan tadi TC yang diambil dari luar daerah, itu kita sering memperkirakan waktu yang lebih lama untuk pengajaran. Karena kita, ya jadi ini mungkin akan membuat mahasiswa yang di kelas yang sama, itu akan menunggu lebih lama. Dan kita juga, oh ya, ada satu teknik lagi, yaitu kita bisa minta agar peserta, mahasiswa yang berada di kelas yang lebih sama, yang lebih advance daripada temannya, untuk mengajarkan skill mereka. Jadi kalau misalkan temannya itu tidak terbiasa power on komputer, ya teman di sebelahnya itu bisa mengajarkan bagaimana cara power on dan boot komputer sampai sampai berada di level yang kita inginkan. Lalu juga kalau misalkan mereka tidak sesama mahasiswa tidak bisa mengajarkan, jadi kita yang harus mengajarkan, itu biasanya setidaknya ada dua instructional librarian ya untuk membantu mahasiswa yang terlambat. Untuk membantu siswa yang terlambat pemahamannya, untuk membantu yang masih macet-macet ya di belakang. Kemudian satu lagi yang meneruskan pembelajaran, meneruskan kurikulum. Tapi kalau misalkan memang satu kelas itu rata-rata semuanya belum bisa, ya itu kita akan mempertimbangkan waktu yang lebih lama. Kita akan memperkirakan bahwa waktu yang diperlukan untuk pelatihan lebih lama karena lebih banyak yang harus kita ajarkan. Ya, jadi kalau misalkan sangat basic sekali reading skills-nya, informasi literasi digitalnya, literasi medianya, literasi komputernya, ya kita juga selain yang diminta yaitu literasi informasi seperti bagaimana dan di mana mencari informasi, kita harus mulai dari literasi komputer seperti itu. Jadi kalau misalkan ada, ya jadi tadi yang pertama kita masuk, kalau misalkan kita sudah tahu profilnya, kita masuk dengan setidaknya dua instructional librarian, satu untuk mengajar di belakang, satu untuk mengajar di depan. Yang kedua, bisa minta partisipasi peserta untuk mengajarkan. Ya, ini untuk di perguruan tinggi ya. Kalau misalkan di sekolah mungkin agak lebih sulit, tapi setidaknya SMP, SMA itu sudah bisa untuk minta teman mengajarkan sesama murid ya. Lalu yang ketiga, kita mempersiapkan waktu yang lebih panjang, memperkirakan waktu yang lebih panjang dalam pengajaran. Seperti itu, yang selama ini suka di kami lakukan, kami praktekkan dalam kelas literasi informasi. Gitu. Oke, terjawab ya Bu Uli? Ya, jadi ya ada informasi juga dari Pak Dama. Ya, tadi saya membahas tentang platform untuk sharing kurikulum EL. Ya, di Indonesia kita sudah ada program dari FPPTI Pusat. Ya, padahal sudah tulis di chat, saya jelaskan lagi. Kelas pengembangan literasi informasi yang disebut ALIPI, Akademi Literasi Informasi Pustakawan Indonesia, yang sudah bisa diakses dan sesinya akan terus bertambah sampai ratusan sesi. Jadi untuk sekarang ini masih grand opening, soft opening ya. Jadi sudah ada kelas-kelas yang bisa diakses di sana untuk yang tertarik untuk mengembangkan skill-nya, skill literasi informasi dan pengajaran literasi informasi, bisa join untuk mempersiapkan diri sebagai instructional librarian. Sudah ada link-nya, sudah diberikan ya oleh Pak Dama. Ya, Pak Dama ini sendiri adalah tadi selain manajer perpustakaan UPH, beliau juga pegiat literasi informasi. Ya, tadi di slide Mem Cheryl sudah ada estimasi beliau dan perkiraan tentang literasi informasi. Ya. Apakah ada lagi pertanyaan? Kalau misalkan mau bertanya langsung, boleh juga untuk langsung open mic untuk bertanya ke Mem Cheryl. Boleh bahasa Indonesia dulu juga, nanti bisa diterjemahkan, dibantu ke dalam bahasa Inggris. Sudah, jadi sudah terjawab semua pertanyaan ya. Jadi ya, ya tadi, ya apakah ada pertanyaan? Tadi ada pertanyaan literasi, oke. Okay. Ya, info tambahan lagi yang tadi ditanyakan penggunaan SPSS, PLS, dan lain-lain juga akan termasuk di dalam sesi ALIPI karena itu termasuk dalam literasi riset. Ya, jadi penggunaannya. Ya, jadi untuk kompetensi sebagai instructional librarian kita bisa mendapatkan dari berbagai sumber ya. Oke, Ma'am Cheryl, so we have a question that can the participants in this event contact you for a consultation about the instructional librarian program in their library?
If it's about the actual instructional information literacy program, I think Pak Dama is actually the expert in Indonesia, given that he's been successfully running the Big Six program here. I mean, I would be happy to try to answer any questions for anyone. But I'm more about the larger structure, and Pak Dama is more about the details of a specific program. But of course, I'd be willing to respond to any emails if anyone sends me any. But I do think Pak Dama is the number one expert in all of Indonesia on information literacy. It's been his passion for years and years and years. Although he's not as old as me, so.
Okay, yeah, so, I think there is your email in the PowerPoint. Okay, yeah, we will, yeah, if there is anyone who wants to contact us, you can contact the committee. Yeah, we will have a contact information later on. So that's the end of the question and answer session. If you want to give a closing statement, Ma'am Cheryl?
Other than it's just been a delight to be able to meet with you today. I wish it was in person so I could actually meet you face to face and shake hands afterwards. So obviously doing this through Zoom is not ideal, but I'm sure it's allowing for those of you that aren't in the immediate area here to actually attend. And you didn't have to deal with any traffic to get here. But again, I'm thankful for the opportunity to share about my knowledge about the importance of instructional librarians as I'm familiar with it from my years of working as a director of a university library in America, and hopefully encouraging those of you here in Indonesia that recognize too that this is an important thing. One of probably the most important things you can do for your university library is make sure that you have a sound instruction program in place. As I think I heard Yani say at the beginning when she was introducing some other stuff, one of the biggest problems nowadays is information overload for people. There's too much information. And it really takes knowledge and skills in navigating the information landscape for students to succeed, for lecturers to be able to accomplish their tasks efficiently. And a lot of that is learning how to use information well, to become lifelong learners of information, to use it well, so that you can be a productive citizen, right? And so information literacy and instructional librarians are a very important part of this at the university stage in someone's knowledge development in their life. So again, thank you for the opportunity. And I hope we have more opportunities down the road to share great ideas about how to improve our libraries for the benefit of the citizens of Indonesia. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Cheryl Taylor, for your presentation and your sharing of knowledge about the instructional librarian. So with this, we end the presentation. So I give back to MC, Devi.
Terima kasih, moderator. Baik, Bapak-Ibu, untuk materi webinar pada hari ini, Bapak-Ibu dan rekan-rekan bisa mendapatkan di link yang sudah tersedia di kolom chat atau scan barcode yang tertera di layar. Dan juga, Bapak-Ibu dan rekan-rekan, kami mohon kesediaannya untuk mengisi form evaluasi yang sudah kami bagikan di kolom chat atau yang tertera pada layar. Adapun evaluasi ini akan menjadi masukan bagi kami selaku penyelenggara acara untuk memberikan yang terbaik lagi pada event-event berikutnya. Silahkan kami berikan waktu dan tempat. Baik, selanjutnya akan ada hadiah yang kita berikan kepada Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan sekalian. Tentu dengan mengikuti kuis yang nanti akan dipandu oleh kami. Namun sebelumnya, kita saksikan dulu video sponsor dari EBSCO berikut ini.
What path does your research journey take? Oftentimes, discovery platforms reveal countless keyword hits, giving you a lot of results, many of which may not be relevant or useful. Fortunately, EBSCO Discovery Service, or EDS, has a smarter way to search, no matter if you're a novice researcher or an expert. EDS provides the most effective and user-friendly search experience, delivering precise and meaningful results across billions of records. The caliber of data underpinning the search experience includes unique, high-quality subject indexes, controlled vocabularies, and various thesauri that are leveraged to ensure that you find the best resources your institution offers in nearly any area of research. Using your own words, type what you're looking for into the search box to access your library's wealth of information. EDS recommends a research starter to spark some ideas, or you can dive right into the search results. While other platforms are not intelligent enough to surface relevant and meaningful results from the myriad of possible research paths, EDS has the smarts to give you the results you need in the time you need it by finding the most current, on-point, peer-reviewed materials for your chosen research topic. And you can add specificity to your search by selecting filters such as location, source type, publisher, and more. Now, what if you don't know the specific research terminology used for your topic and want to learn about related topics? EDS's unique enhanced subject precision maps search terms to topics with the same meaning, making sure you don't miss any materials for your search. But what if you want to take your research a step further, beyond the results list of your subject of choice? Let's say that in addition to the extensive EDS results list, you also want to actually see the connections to related subjects or concepts. A search in the EDS concept map reveals that 3D printing can refer to the process itself or the service. If you meant the 3D printing process, you can refine your search to the exact content you are aiming for and find related concepts that let you drive your search into research facets you may never have discovered otherwise. Understanding context and correlations across related concepts can open new avenues of study and inspire further research. In the concept map, once you discover a related topic you're interested in, expand that concept to find out its context, how it relates to your research, and even add it to the content preview to see how it would affect your search results. If you like where your search is heading, by clicking on See Full Results, you can return to EDS and execute your new, refined search, giving you a focused, deep dive into related research avenues. Avenues that may be a missing link between your research and that of a new discovery, adding to the body of knowledge for that research topic. If you like certain results more than others, you can keep track by clicking the like or share buttons, just as you would on your favorite social media platforms. Even getting citations for all your research articles is simple and fast. And setting up a personalized dashboard allows you to save the best articles for reading later. From start to finish, and at every step in your research journey, EDS empowers you to find expert, meaningful results and get the most out of your library's resources. So, what do you want to learn next?
Baik, Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan, sekali lagi, jika masih ada yang belum mengisi link evaluasi, kami mohon kesediaannya untuk mengisi form evaluasi yang sudah kami bagikan di kolom chat, karena evaluasi ini akan menjadi masukan bagi kami selaku penyelenggara acara untuk memberikan yang terbaik lagi pada event-event berikutnya. Silahkan. Ya, sekali lagi terselenggaranya acara webinar pada hari ini tentu tidaklah lepas dari dukungan para sponsor. Maka dari itu kami ucapkan terima kasih untuk sponsor Canon, EBSCO, McGraw-Hill, sehingga acara ini dapat terselenggara dengan baik. Baik, nah Tibalah saatnya kita pada sesi kuis yang selanjutnya akan dipandu oleh Bapak Kevin. Untuk Pak Kevin, waktu dan tempat kami persilahkan.
Baik, terima kasih MC. Baik Bapak Ibu, saya akan share dulu yang bisa Bapak Ibu join di Join My Quiz. Lalu nanti tinggal enter kodenya 130392. Mungkin untuk panitia bisa dituliskan di kolom chat, joinmyquiz.com, lalu enter code 130392. Untuk Bapak-Ibu dan rekan-rekan, mohon gunakan nama asli ya, biar kami nanti bisa men-track siapa pemenangnya. Dan nanti untuk pemenang, bisa silakan langsung menghubungi panitia. Di akhir acara, kami akan share kontak kami, IG, WA, dan WhatsApp yang bisa Bapak-Ibu kontak. Oke, ada 8. Kita masih tunggu untuk semua partisipan. Sistemnya adalah yang selain ketepatan dan diukur juga kecepatannya dalam menjawab ya, Bapak Ibu dan rekan-rekan. Jadi selain jawabannya benar, kecepatan dalam menjawab juga dihitung untuk poinnya. Oke, baru 40. Mari Bapak-Ibu yang lain bisa ikut bergabung. Gunakan juga nama asli ya Bapak-Ibu dan rekan-rekan biar kami nanti bisa mengkonfirmasi siapa pemenangnya. Oke, kita sebentar lagi akan mulai ya. Mungkin yang lainnya belum bisa bergabung. Kita tunggu dulu sebentar, Bapak Ibu. Oke, baik Bapak Ibu, kita akan langsung mulai aja ya. Silakan siap-siap semuanya untuk perhatikan device masing-masing. Kita mulai. Thank you.
sudah habis. Nah, kita lihat pemenangnya. Oke, selamat kepada pemenang. Cak, nanti untuk bisa menghubungi panitia, kontak akan kami informasikan di akhir acara. Oke, saya kembalikan lagi ke MC. Silahkan MC. Terima kasih atas waktu dan tempatnya.
Baik, terima kasih. Untuk sertifikat, Bapak-Ibu dan rekan-rekan bisa langsung mendownload di link yang sudah ditaruh di kolom chat atau scan barcode yang ada di layar. Untuk panduan juga sudah tertera di layar, Bapak-Ibu bisa mengikutinya. Jika terdapat kesalahan di sertifikat, baik berupa penulisan nama atau kekeliruan lainnya, silakan mengajukan komplain ke narahubung kami. Akan ditunggu setelah acara ini selesai sampai maksimal pukul 4 sore di hari ini. Sekali lagi, jika terdapat kesalahan di sertifikat, baik berupa penulisan nama atau kekeliruan lainnya, Bapak-Ibu dan rekan-rekan silakan mengajukan komplain ke narahubung kami yang akan ditunggu setelah acara ini selesai sampai maksimal pukul 4 sore. Baik, Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan sekalian, sebelum kita tutup acara ini, izinkan saya untuk memimpin doa penutup dalam agama Kristen. Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan bisa mengikuti sesuai kepercayaan masing-masing. Mari kita berdoa. Ya Tuhan, kembali kami mengucap syukur untuk berkat-berkat-Mu yang tak pernah berhenti melimpahi kami, terlebih di acara webinar yang telah selesai pada hari ini. Biarlah kiranya apa yang kami dapatkan, apa yang kami dengarkan, bisa berdampak dan berguna bagi kehidupan kami. Kami juga akan kembali ke aktivitas kami masing-masing, biarlah Tuhan Engkau yang turut bekerja, dan kami serahkan hidup kami senantiasa ke dalam tangan-Mu. Amin. Baik, sekali lagi Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan, terima kasih kami ucapkan untuk sponsor Canon, EBSCO, McGraw-Hill, sehingga acara ini dapat terselenggara dengan baik. Dan selanjutnya, berikut ini adalah poster keseluruhan acara Libanef terdekat yang akan diselenggarakan. Besar harapan kami, Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan bisa ikut berpartisipasi. Webinar di tanggal 6 Mei dengan pembicara Bapak Ade Armando. Lalu tanggal 8 Mei ada Semiloka Perpustakaan Digital Gereja. Keseluruhan posternya. Ya, harapan kami Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan bisa berpartisipasi dengan menghubungi kontak narahubung kami. Ya, bisa via WhatsApp, bisa via email, dan juga bisa via Instagram. Baik, Bapak, Ibu, dan rekan-rekan, kini tibalah saatnya kita di penghujung acara. Kami mohon maaf yang sebesar-besarnya jika terdapat hal yang sekiranya kurang berkenan, baik dalam proses persiapan hingga penyelenggaraan acara webinar pada hari ini. Terima kasih juga yang sebesar-besarnya kami ucapkan kepada partisipasi Bapak dan Ibu sekalian. Kami harapkan untuk ikut di acara rangkaian webinar Libanef 2021 selanjutnya. Saya Devi Kristiani Zega, mohon pamit, salam sehat, terima kasih.